here, but a seconder or anybody would like to speak that motion might now work their way over to the microphone in zone one. Could we have a spotlight on where that is? And that way, when we get to that point of the program, if anybody that would like to speak to the motion that was in the proxy statement, if you'll work your way over to the microphone there, then we'll be ready at the time. You can be ready at the time when it'll be appropriate to talk about it. And so we'll get there in just a minute, and if you'll all wander over there that are interested. Also with us today are partners in the firm of Deloitte & Touche, our auditors. They are available to respond to appropriate questions you might have concerning their firm's audit of the accounts of Berkshire. Mr. Forrest Crutter is Secretary of Berkshire. He will make a written record of the proceedings. Ms. Becky Amick has been appointed Inspector of Elections at this meeting. She will certify to the count of votes cast in the election for directors. The named proxy holders for the meeting are Walter Scott Jr. and Mark D. Hamburg. We will conduct the business of the meeting and then adjourn the formal meeting. After that, we will entertain questions that you might have. Does the Secretary have a report of the number of Berkshire shares outstanding entitled to vote and represented at the meeting?
Yes, I do. As indicated in the proxy statement that accompanied the notice of this meeting that was sent by first-class mail to all shareholders of record on March 6, 2002, being the record date for this meeting, there were 1,323,707 shares of Class A Berkshire Hathaway common stock outstanding, with each share entitled to one vote on motions considered at the meeting, and 6,290,415 shares of Class B Berkshire Hathaway common stock outstanding, with each share entitled to 1/200th of one vote on motions considered at the meeting. Of that number, 1,103,455 Class A shares and 5,260,231 Class B shares are represented at this meeting by proxies returned through Thursday evening, May 2nd.
Thank you. That number represents a quorum, and we will therefore directly proceed with the meeting. First order of business will be a reading of the minutes of the last meeting of shareholders. I recognize Mr. Walter Scott, who will place the motion before the meeting.
I move that the reading of the minutes of the last meeting of the shareholders be dispensed with and the minutes be approved.
Do I hear a second? The motion has been moved and seconded. Are there any comments or questions? 3-second pause. We will vote on this motion by voice vote. All those in favor say aye. Opposed? The motion's carried. First item of business of this meeting is to elect directors. The shareholder is present who wishes to withdraw a proxy previously sent in and vote in person on the election of directors, he or she may do so. Also, if any shareholder that is present has not turned in a proxy and desires a ballot in order to vote in person, you may do so. If you wish to do this, please identify yourself to meeting officials in the aisles who will furnish a ballot to you. Would those persons desiring ballots please identify themselves so that we may distribute these. I now recognize Mr. Walter Scott to place a motion before the meeting with respect to election of directors.
I move that Warren E. Buffett, Charles T. Munger, Susan T. Buffett, Howard G. Buffett, Malcolm G. Chase, Ronald L. Olson, and Walter Scott Jr. be elected as directors.
There a second? It's been moved and seconded that Warren E. Buffett, Charles T. Munger, Susan T. Buffett, Howard G. Buffett, Malcolm D. Chase, Ronald L. Olson, and Walter Scott Jr. be elected as directors. Sounds like a hell of a slate to me. Are there any other nominations? Is there any discussion? Nominations are ready to be acted upon. If there are any shareholders voting in person, they should now mark their ballots on the election of directors and allow the ballots to be delivered to the Inspector of Election. The proxy holders, please also submit to the Inspector of Elections a ballot on the election of directors, voting the proxies in accordance with the instructions they have received. Now, I will have to say at this point, deviating from my script, that in the spirit of disclosure, which now permeates the corporate world, I have a tally here from yesterday as to the number of votes each director has received. And I won't give the affirmative votes, but the total basically negative votes, it's a withhold vote. Charlie and I and Howie came in last. By a significant margin. Susie did the best. She only had 1,000 votes against her, but Charlie and I had 16,000 some votes against us. So I really suspect that Susie voted against us so that she could lead the ticket, but who knows? Ms. Amick, when you're ready, you may give your report.
My report is ready. The ballot of the proxy holders in response to proxies that were received through last Thursday evening cast not less than 1,139,672 votes for each nominee. That number far exceeds a majority of the number of the total votes related to all Class A and Class B shares outstanding. The certification required by Delaware law of the precise count of the votes, including the additional votes to be cast by the proxy holders in response to proxies delivered at this meeting, as well as any cast in person at this meeting, will be given to the secretary to be placed with the minutes of this meeting.
Thank you, Ms. Amick. Warren E. Buffett, Susan D. Buffett, Howard G. Buffett, Malcolm G. Chase, Charles D. Munger, Ronald L. Olson, and Walter Scott Jr. have been elected as directors. Next. The next item of business is a proposal put forth by a Berkshire shareholder, Gloria J. Patrick, the owner of two Class B shares. Ms. Patrick's motion is set forth in the proxy statement and provides that the shareholders request the company to refrain from making charitable contributions. The directors have recommended that the shareholders vote against this proposal. We will now open the floor to recognize Ms. Patrick or her designee to present her proposal. And I believe we have Mr. Mosher at the microphone in Area 1 to make the proposal and speak to it. Would you go ahead, please, sir?
Thank you, Chairman Buffett. I apologize if this is a little loud. I was told I would have to really project, but I think you can hear me up there on the stage, and I hope you can hear me up in the rafters. My name is Stephen Mosher. I'm the chairman of the Population Research Institute, a nonprofit organization dedicated to making the case for people as the ultimate resource, the one resource that we as investors cannot do without, and to debunking the hype about overpopulation, what the New York Times has called, and I quote, one of the myths of the 20th century. Of course, we're now living in the 21st century. I've written about the coming depopulation, that's right, I said depopulation, in the Wall Street Journal and other publications. I say all this to explain why Gloria Patrick, a Berkshire Hathaway shareholder, has asked me to present for action at this meeting the following proposal. And I do have one other qualification. I have 9 children. Now, when people gasp at this, I remind them that my children will be paying their Social Security one day. Of course, if you invest in Berkshire Hathaway stock, you won't need Social Security. I will present the proposal and then, with the chairman's indulgence, spend a couple of minutes explaining why it's necessary. Here is the resolution. Whereas, charitable contributions should serve to enhance shareholder value. Whereas, the company has given money to groups involved in controversial activities like population control and abortion. Whereas, our company is dependent on people to buy the products and services of the various companies we own. Whereas, our company is being boycotted by Life Decisions International and investment-related groups like Provida Advisors because of these contributions. Resolved, the shareholders request the company to refrain from making charitable contributions. Let me take these very quickly, point by point. You all know shareholder money is entrusted to the board of directors to be invested in a prudent manner for the shareholders. I think you will all agree, as the resolution states, that charitable contributions should serve to enhance shareholder value. Indeed, this is already Berkshire Hathaway policy with regard to its operating subsidiaries. As Chairman Buffett explained in his chairman's letter of last year, quote, we trust our managers to make gifts in a manner that delivers commensurate, tangible, or intangible benefits to the operations they manage. We did not invest money in this company so it could be given to someone else's favorite charity. I think you will also likewise agree that activities like population control and abortion are controversial. In fact, some of the charitable money has been given to Planned Parenthood, a group that is responsible for almost 200,000 abortions a year in the United States. Thank you. And in countless more through its population control programs worldwide. Now, we believe abortion is the taking of a human life, but even if you disagree on this fundamental point, you must concur that these ongoing boycotts of Berkshire Hathaway Company products are not a good thing. Next, it should be self-evident that Berkshire Hathaway, like the economy as a whole, is dependent upon people. It is people who produce the products and services of the various companies we own, and it is people who buy them. Now, you may think that there is a superabundance of people in the world and that we will never run short, but this is not true. Half of the countries of the world, including countries in Latin America, Africa, and Asia, now have birth rates below replacement. Europe and Japan are literally dying, filling more coffins than cradles each year. Dying populations may shrink the economic pie. We already see this happening in Japan and some European countries. How much of Japan's continuing economic malaise can be directly traced to a lack of young people to power the economy? Dying populations may also make economic development nearly impossible. Russia is having trouble finding its feet economically. Why? Because of its ongoing demographic collapse, losing 1 million people a year. These problems will spread to many more countries in the near future. Charitable contributions to simple-minded population control programs, in which governments impose restrictions on childbearing, are not in Berkshire Hathaway's interest. Such programs are not investing in humanity's future. They are compromising humanity's future and putting a roadblock in the way of future economic growth. There is no global share buyback in store for those who fund population control programs, because such programs will rob the world of future consumers and producers and threaten to shrink the economic pie. Let me give you a concrete example of what I mean. Berkshire Hathaway owns Dairy Queen. Now, there are 103 Dairy Queens in Thailand, but Thailand, due to a massive population control campaign, now has a birth rate that is below replacement and falling. This means that its cohorts of young children are shrinking. There will be fewer and fewer families in the years to come, and its population will eventually fall. Now, you may think Thailand has too many children, but is it possible for there to be too many children for Dairy Queen? According to Dairy Queen, the Dairy Queen concept especially appeals to, quote, young families, but there will be fewer young families in Thailand's future and Dairy Queen's future because of population control. So I urge you to vote yes on this resolution. Let it be resolved that this company refrain from making charitable contributions. One final point. Should you, on the other hand, vote to continue the current practice of making charitable contributions based on shareholder designations, I would urge you all to designate 501c3s, like the Population Research Institute, which are attempting to help the poor become the agents of their own development and not simply try to reduce their number through population control. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this opportunity to speak.
Thank you. Do we have a second to the motion? Okay. And is there any further discussion? Is there anyone there at the microphone that would like to talk?
Not invited anymore.
No. Okay. If there's no further discussion, we'll have Ms. Amick report on the votes cast on that. If anybody wishes to cast a vote in person, they can raise their hand and submit that. But we'll have a preliminary report from Ms. Amick.
My report is ready. The ballot of the proxy holders in response to the proxies that were received through last Thursday evening casts 28,452 votes for the motion and 1,014,353 votes against the motion. As the number of votes against the motion exceeds a majority of the number of votes related to all Class A and Class B shares outstanding, the motion has failed. The certification required by Delaware law of the precise count of the votes will be given to the Secretary to be placed with the minutes of this meeting.
Thank you, Ms. Amick. The proposal fails. After adjournment of the business meeting, I will respond to questions that you may have that relate to the businesses of Berkshire but do not call for any action at this meeting. Does anyone have any further business to come before this meeting before we adjourn? If not, I recognize Mr. Walter Scott to place a motion before the meeting.
I move that this meeting be adjourned.
Is there a second? Motion to adjourn has been made and seconded. We will vote by voice. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor say aye. Opposed say no. The meeting's adjourned. Thank you. Now, before we get on to the questions, and when we get to the questions, we will move through various zones sequentially. There are just a few special guests that I would like to recognize, and because of the crowd, I've not had an opportunity to make sure all of these special guests are here, but we will find out here shortly. The first guest, and I hope very much he's here, he was planning to be here, let's see, 48 years ago, this July or so, well, about June, I got a letter from Ben Graham, who I'd been pestering for a job for about 3 years and getting no place, and Ben said, next time you're in New York, come in and talk to me. So I was there about 10 hours later. I didn't have a NetJets plane then, so it took a little longer, and I went in to see Ben, and he offered me a job, and I took it on the spot. I didn't ask what the salary was or anything else, and a month or two later, the family joined me. I had my daughter was already born, and Susie was pregnant with Howie, and we moved back there, and I went to work for Graham Newman Corp. And one of my three bosses, I had three bosses, Ben Graham, Jerry Newman, and Mickey Newman. And Mickey was exactly 10 years older than I was at that time, and he's exactly 10 years older now. And Mickey was a major factor in a hugely successful, he ran the place, company that was not quite that successful yet in 1954 when I went back there, the Philadelphia and Reading Coal and Iron Company, as it was called then. And after I'd been there maybe a year, Mickey was in charge of Philadelphia and Reading, and a fellow named Jack Goldfarb came into the office, and I really didn't know what was going on. I had a good bit of my net worth in Philadelphia and Reading, so I was interested. But Jack Goldfarb and Mickey were behind closed doors largely. But when they emerged, the Philadelphia and Reading Company, which was controlled by Graham Newman, had bought Union Underwear, which was the manufacturer of Fruit of the Loom product under a license at that time. And as I told in the annual report, it was a very, very attractive buy, and Mickey made a number of good buys. And when Mickey and I have talked and seen each other over the years, some not a lot, but we would see each other. And when Fruit of the Loom entered bankruptcy a few years ago, Mickey called me and sort of said, what are you going to do about it? You should do something. And he was very helpful, particularly helpful in introducing me to John Holland, who runs Fruit of the Loom and who's a tremendous asset to the company. And Mickey gave me lots of insights on that. And when I got discouraged with the bankruptcy procedure, and it is discouraging to try and buy a company out of bankruptcy, Mickey would gently prod me along. And so I believe today we have with us Mickey Newman and his son, who I last saw when he was a little redheaded kid, Bill. And Mickey and Bill, if you're here, if you'd stand up, it'd be great. Now let's see if they made it. There they are. Let's have a spotlight on them. I can't see very well from here whether Bill's still redheaded, but Mickey is 81, believe it or not. You won't believe it if you meet him. And he's been a tremendous help and a great friend over the years. And he accomplished much for us in the past year. I don't think we would have Fruit of the Loom if it hadn't been for Mickey, particularly nudging me along as we went through the process. I also hope we have today with us, and I didn't get a chance to see them before the meeting, but are Ralph and Lucy Shea here? Ralph and Lucy, were they able to make it or not? Yeah, there they are. But Ralph is in the Berkshire Hathaway Hall of Fame. I mean, this is like being at Cooperstown, you know, and introducing Bob Gibson or Sandy Koufax. And Ralph, for a great many years, added tremendous value to Berkshire at Scott & Fetzer. We wouldn't be able to buy some of the things like Fruit of the Loom if it hadn't been for the profits developed under Ralph's management at Scott Fetzer. So I'm delighted that he and Lucy can join us. I believe, and I hope we have Larry and Dolores Brandon. Are they here? Could be. Joey, there they are. Let's have a spotlight on them. Dolores is also known as Dutchie, but we call her Saint Dutchie at Berkshire headquarters because she gave birth some years ago to Joe Brandon, and Joe has been doing a fabulous job for us at General Re. He took over early in September. It's really going to be our number one asset. There's been a lot happen since that those days in September when Joe took over. I think you're going to see some terrific results throughout our insurance business, but particularly at General Re. I wrote Dutchie a letter, and I said, you know, it's terrific what you've done for us, but you know, I was a little like the farmer that went into the hen house, and I, you know, pulled out an ostrich egg and said to the hens, you know, that I don't like to complain, but this is just a sample of what the competition's doing. Well, I berated her a little bit for not having twins, because if she just had a twin for Joe, I mean, there's no, we'd own the world. But she tells me that she wrote me back and said, oh, she really had done her best. I mean, she'd had 7 children, 5 of whom are in the insurance business, and she has 19 grandchildren. So we have people out on the road trying to sign up these grandchildren now. And if you get a chance, you know, tell her productive years are not over. And finally, we have with us today the fellow who put together that terrific cartoon. Anybody that can even takes on the job of making me look like James Bond is a very brave person. And Andy Hayward has a company called Deke Entertainment, which is a leading producer of children's programming. When you turn on the television on Saturday morning, you will be seeing his output. And Andy puts this product together. He sends people to Omaha. He does it all. It's his script. It's his production. He does it on his own time, on his own nickel. It's his contribution to the Berkshire meeting. And it's absolutely fabulous. And I have to tell you that this fall, Andy is going to have a series of 40 episodes that are called, I think it's called Liberty's Kids. It will be on public broadcasting at 4:30, 5 days a week, and it's really the story of America. It's told, Charlie will like this, Charlie doesn't know about this, it will be told through the eyes of 3 young apprentices in Ben Franklin's print shop. And it will view the evolving of the American democracy and the Constitution, and all with Andy's creative characters, but it will use the voices of various other people, and I'm flattered. I get to be James Madison in this, and we have Sylvester Stallone, we have Billy Crystal, we have Whoopi Goldberg, and Charlie will be crushed to find, I think it's Walter Cronkite is going to be Ben Franklin. I mean, that I think Charlie held out for too much money or something in this. But it's going to be a fabulous series. I mean, I am looking forward to this. It'll run all this year, starting in the fall, and then it will run again the following year, and it will be a great, great piece for American children and American adults. I plan on watching it myself, and it will just be the story of how this country came about through the eyes of these 3 young apprentices of Ben Franklin. So Andy is here with his son Michael, and if Andy and Michael would stand up, I'd like to give him a hand myself. Andy, where are you? We're here someplace. We've got a lot of other special guests, but they're up here in our manager's sections. You saw them up on the screen. They're the people that make this place work. We have a larger and better cast this year than we've had even in the past, and it'll grow in the future. This is a company of managers, and we confess to how little we do around headquarters, as you saw in the movie, and we now have, I think, I'm not sure of the exact number, whether we had it's 130,000 now or something like that, people working all over the world in all kinds of occupations. And I think they get a sense when they come here that they're working for real people on this side, too. I mean, they get to see people who are actual owners. So we have some institutional owners, but we have 350,000 individual owners now. And I believe it's correct to say that our stock turns over, there's less turnover in the shares of Berkshire than any other company of major size in the country, which means, in effect, we have more what I would call real owners, people who want to be in partnership with the kind of managers we have, and Charlie and I are very proud of them. Now, we're going to get to the questions in just one second. I thought I would give you a little update on particularly the insurance aspects of the first quarter, because insurance cost us a lot of money last year. It's our main business. It's always going to be our main business. It's a very, very big business, and it's going to get bigger. And there were some special events of last year, and there were some mistakes of our own that made it a bad year for insurance last year. Our float last year cost us almost 13%, and that's a lot to pay for money. It's not our record. We had a period in the 80s when we ran into even more difficulties. But I think there's been, I know there's been a change in the market. There's been a change to a degree in the culture at a very important unit. And I think that barring some really mega catastrophe, and we'll talk about those later possibilities, that we are... I think we're doing pretty well, and if we could have the first chart, the first chart, which I can't see myself here, but I think it will be the insurance underwriting results for the first quarter, and you will see that two good things happened in the first quarter. One is our float increased by $1.8 billion. That's a lot of money to take in net. I don't think there's any company probably in the world that had a gain in float that was even close to that. And we actually achieved that with a small underwriting profit. So the float not only cost us nothing in the first quarter, but we had a gain of $1.8 billion in it. And all units contributed to that. Our goal is to obtain more and more float at minimal or no cost. And there have been a number of years in the past when we've run an underwriting profit, which means that the use of that money is essentially free, or even better than free. And we've had one very bad year and a couple of so-so years before that. But I think our cost of float over the next few years, unless you get into an extraordinary catastrophe, I think it should be pretty satisfactory. Now, you'll notice there's a note down at the bottom that's slightly technical, but it's an important enough item in Berkshire and in understanding our cost of float that I thought I'd just devote a minute to it. If you find this uninteresting, you can live a happy life without understanding what I'm about to explain next. You may even lead a happier life if you don't understand it. As I look at the people that understand it and don't understand it, I'm not sure which group is happier. But when we write a good bit, and have written a good bit, I should say, of retroactive insurance. Now, in retroactive insurance, a company may come to us that's merging with another company, and they want to put a cap on their liabilities or define them better. From past incidents. So they may come to us and say, we want you to pick up all the losses that are going to be paid from things that happened prior to, say, 1990. And we think that we owe $1 billion have yet to be paid in losses from that period, but we want to protect ourselves up to, say, $2 billion or some number like that. So they write us a check, And we take over, this is called retroactive insurance, we take over their losses from the past for a specific period and for a specific amount. And when we do that, the accounting, it's not accounting you run into every day, we've explained it in the past, but it creates a charge which will occur over time in the future. And as you can see, in the first quarter, the $20 million of underwriting profit we made was after a total of $112 million for the amortization of this charge that is set up. So if a company comes in and says, for example, we want you to protect us up to $1.5 billion for losses that occurred in the past, and we'll give you $1 billion for it, we will debit cash for $1 billion, and we'll debit this deferred charge for half a billion, and we'll set up a liability for $1.5 billion. And that $500 million we set up as a deferred charge, we amortize over a period of time as we expect to pay the claims. Now, there would be a lot of room for judgment. There is a lot of room for judgment in terms of how fast we amortize that. We try to be conservative. We make an estimate of when we will pay those claims and how much we will pay, and we try to amortize it over a reasonable period. I've got another slide that shows how those amortization charges will work over time. And we're going to put these slides on the internet because we feel that our shareholders should understand the impact of these charges that will come against underwriting profits. In the year 2002, we will have a $400 million-plus charge for this. It's built into the figures now. And if we do $20 billion of premium volume, that's about a 2% charge. So to have our float be cost-free, we have to make $400 plus million on underwriting elsewhere in order to offset that. And as you can see, we did that the first quarter, and we'll find out whether we do it for the full year. It's a peculiar, not many companies do this kind of business, and it's a big item with us, so I really want all the shareholders to understand it, and for that reason, we'll put it on the internet. I should emphasize that in all of these contracts, we cap our liability. So a lot of these contracts apply to liabilities that primarily, or not primarily, but in a significant way, and often primarily, arise from asbestos. But when you read about asbestos claims accelerating and all of that, the numbers are capped in our case, so in all of these contracts. So we really don't care whether we pay it on an asbestos claim or whether we pay it on an old auto liability claim or whatever. The question is whether we've been correct in estimating the speed at which we will pay. And in some cases, we may pay even less than our maximum amount. So anyway, that's available for those of you who previously were unhappy not understanding this and now are thrilled to know how it all works. Now, the final item, which is a little easier to understand, is we talked in the annual report about how we expected growth to resume at GEICO, and I put up, again, I can't see whether they're up there, but I assume that we have the GEICO policies in force figure and the increase by, Charlie hasn't seen these as a matter of fact, so I'll give him the slides. And as you can see, growth, not at the rates of a couple of years ago, but quite a turnaround from last year. Growth has resumed at GEICO in a reasonable way. We figure each policyholder of a preferred nature is worth $1,000 to us at least. And so if we add 40,000 policyholders in a month, we've created, in our view, $40 million of value. And of course, we have the earnings and the float and so on that goes with it. As you'll notice on the first slide, GEICO operated at a significant underwriting profit in the first quarter. So all of its float was free, and its float has continued to grow. You saw one of our little squirrel ads there, which I liked. We are not getting a whole lot more inquiries than a year ago, but we're closing a significantly higher percentage of those that call. So our growth has been picking up because our closure rate has increased quite substantially, and our retention rate of old policyholders also is increasing month by month. So we've got two trends that are quite favorable in terms of adding business, and the third one of adding more inquiries
is something that we are working on, and we're delighted to spend a lot of money on it if we can figure out the way to spend it intelligently. But the increase in the retention ratio, the increase in the closure ratio is resulting in very decent growth at GEICO, and it's growth in all of our categories, in the preferred class and the standard class and the non-standard class of business, whereas last year the latter two fell. Well, that's enough about the formal presentation. Now we're going to go in the various zones. I promised the young shareholder in zone one that he would get to ask the first question, and that we're ready for zone one.
Hello, Mr. Buffett and Mr. Munger. My name is David Klein Rodick from Lincolnshire, Illinois. Thank you for letting me ask the first question. I wanted to say I am sorry for the loss of your friend, Mrs. Graham, last year. My question is, you have said that your favorite time to own a stock is forever, yet you sold McDonald's and Disney after not owning them for long. How do you decide when to hold forever and when to sell? And also, are you and Mr. Munger wearing Fruit of the Looms?
Charlie? I think I better answer the question. I can answer unequivocally, I am wearing Fruit of the Loom. And I'm not sure whether Charlie wears underwear, do you?
I haven't. I haven't bought any new underwear in a long time, and therefore I'm inappropriately attired.
He's waiting for a discount. Don't let him kid you. Well, the answer, it's a very good question about selling. I mean, it's not our natural inclination to sell. And on the other hand, and we have held the Washington Post stock since 1973. I've never sold a share of Berkshire, having bought the first shares in 1962. And we've held Coke stock since 1988. We've held Gillette stock since 1989. Held American Express stock since 1991. We had actually previously been in American Express in the 60s in Disney. So there are companies we're familiar with. We generally sell, we would sell if we needed money for something else, but that has not been the problem in the last 10 or 15 years. That 40 years ago, my sales were all because I found something that I liked even better. I hated to sell what I sold, but I also didn't want to borrow money. So I would reluctantly sell something that I thought was terribly cheap to buy something that was even cheaper. Those were the times when I had more ideas than money. Now I've got more money than ideas, and that's a different equation. So now we sell really when we think that when we're reevaluating the economic characteristics of the business. In other words, if you don't want to name names, but take a stock we've sold of some sort. We probably had one view of the long-term competitive advantage of the company at the time we bought it, and we may have modified that. That doesn't mean we think that the company is going into some disastrous period or anything remotely like that. We think McDonald's has a fine future. We think Disney has a fine future, and there are others. But we probably don't think that their competitive advantage is as strong as we might have thought, as we thought it was when we initially made the decision. That may mean that we were wrong when we made the decision originally. It may mean that we're wrong now, and that their strengths are every bit as what they were before. But for one reason or another, we think that the strengths may have been eroded to some degree. A classic case on that would be the newspaper industry generally, for example. I mean, in 1970, if Charlie and I were looking at the newspaper business, we felt it was about as impregnable a franchise as could be found. We still think it's quite a business, but we do not think the franchise in 2002 is the same as it was in 1970. We do not think the franchise of a network television station in 2002
is the same as it was in 1965. And those beliefs change quite gradually, and who knows whether they're precise, you know, whether they're right even, but that is the reason in general that we sell now. If we got into some terribly cheap market, we might sell some things that we thought were cheap to buy something even cheaper after we'd bought lots and lots of equities, but that's not the occasion right now. Charlie?
Nothing to add.
He's been practicing for weeks. Okay, let's go to zone two.
I'm John Bailey from Boston, Massachusetts, and I hope I'm not asking you to repeat your insurance presentation, but I have a question about the growth of our float. There's a increasingly popular piece of analysis out there where people project the growth of float for a large number of years into the future in order to determine the value of our business here. But I wanted to ask more fundamentally, the existing float that we have runs off annually at a pretty considerable rate. In order to maintain that, we have to replace it through our operations. And then going the next step to achieve the growth, we have to more than replace it. And so I wanted to ask you to address the characteristics of the maybe the non-GEICO insurance businesses that should give us the confidence to expect large amounts of replacement and growth float at reasonable costs going forward.
Yeah, in a sense, float is somewhat similar to being in the oil business. I mean, you're every day some goes out as you pay claims, and the question is, did you find more oil than you produced that day? And it's very relevant. It's a good question to, you know, what is the permanence of the float? What is the cost of the float? What's the likelihood of it growing? Could it actually run off? As you saw up on the slide, we have $37 billion plus a float. I think we have more float in our property casualty business. A little bit of that float is in General Re's life and health business, but very small. So basically, you're looking at property casualty float when you look at that $37 billion. I believe that's more than any company has in the United States, and it's possible, I haven't checked Swiss Re in Munich, but it's even possible it's larger than anybody in the world. Now, if you go to 30th and Harney Street here in Omaha, you'll see National Indemnity's building. It's the same building that was there when we bought the company in 1967 from Jack Ringwalt when it had maybe $12 million afloat. And I had no idea that that $12 million or whatever the number was would turn in to $37 billion. I mean, sometimes I can't really quite figure out how it happened, but in any event, it did. And it's, we don't want people focusing on growth in our insurance business. I mean, we want them focusing on intelligent growth when we can do it at a GEICO or whatever it may be, but I think it's suicide from a business standpoint to tell a bunch of insurance managers to go out and grow a lot. So you can say, well, with that lack of push from the home office, you know, how is that $37.5 billion going to grow? And I would say, just as I would have said to you for the last, you know, 30-odd years, I don't know. But I think that, well, I can tell you this, that our float would have less natural runoff than the float from just about any company in the world. I mean, we have a longer duration to our float because it arises from these retroactive contracts and from reinsurance, long-tail reinsurance, and that sort of thing. So our float has less natural erosion than any, just about any that I know of in the world, but it erodes. It is a long-lived oil field, but it we're pumping it every day. You know, if I had to bet my life on whether the float would be higher or lower 3 years from now or 5 years from now, I would certainly bet it would be higher. And it's turned out over the decades, it's grown at a very significant rate, but I don't want to push anybody to do it. It grew at $1.8 billion the first quarter. Now, there are a few special transactions in that, but we seem to attract special transactions. And
there's nothing more important to Berkshire than to have that float at least be maintained, but I would say grow, and it will grow, I think, and to have it be obtained at low cost, because that float did us no good last year at all. That float was lost us a lot of money in the year 2001 because it cost us, I think, 12.8%. And we didn't have a way to make money with 12.8% money. We will make a lot of money if we can obtain the float at no cost as we did in the first quarter. The answer to your question is that without knowing any specifics, that or without being able to promise you any specifics, I think the float is more likely to grow than to erode. I said last year at this meeting that there were, that the float of the American property casualty business was 300 and some billion, and I thought we were sneaking up on 10% of it. I was corrected later. Ron Ferguson pointed out to me that he sent me the figures. The float of the American property casualty business is well over 400 billion. But even at that, we are 8 or 9% or some figure like that of the float of the whole country. And obviously we can't grow at the same percentage rate starting from that kind of a base as we could when we started back in 1967, but I still think we can grow it. Charlie?
Yeah, I think the questioner realizes that growing float at a good clip with very low costs is extremely difficult. It is. It's almost impossible, but we intend to do it anyway.
The two variables, though, the most important thing to do is to focus on getting it at a very low cost. If we get $37 billion at no cost or very low cost, then if we don't make money with that, shame on us. The troops have delivered, and then it's up to Charlie and me to figure out ways to use that money. So the important thing is the cost of the float, not the size of the float, although obviously we would like it to grow, and we'll do what we can to make sure that happens. Area 3.
Good morning, gentlemen. My name is Hugh Stevenson. I'm a shareholder from Atlanta. My question is on asbestos liability tort cases. It seems like this is growing to be a bigger and bigger problem, including more and more companies, including a number of companies in the Dow Jones 30 Industrials. What do you see for Berkshire as the risks and opportunities in the operating and insurance businesses? And if you two were in charge of writing or structuring a settlement for the whole problem, how would you do it?
Okay, I'm going to let Charlie tackle most of that because we've both done a lot of thinking on it. I think Charlie's thinking is that I know it's better and it may even be more extensive. Asbestos, as I mentioned, in some of these retroactive contracts, is a big part of the liability, but it really doesn't make any difference unless it's much more dependent on the speed of payment than the amount of payment. We are capped on all those type of contracts. So there's a figure in the annual report about aggregate asbestos and environmental liability, and that number may look quite big compared to some other insurance companies, but most of that there's a limit on. It's a good thing because asbestos continues to explode. We talked about it last year at this meeting, and I said no matter how bad you thought it was going to be worse, and it has been worse, and it will be worse. And you make a very good point when you bring up the fact that many companies that are thought to be or have been thought to have been insulated from the asbestos litigation have now been dragged in one way or another, and that won't stop either. Ironically, it's not impossible that asbestos litigation actually produces some opportunities for Berkshire in terms of buying companies out of bankruptcy free of their asbestos liabilities. We did that, although it occurred much earlier in the case, but we bought Johns Manville, which was the first major company, really big company, to go into bankruptcy and be forced there by asbestos liability. That happened back in the early 80s. And that subsequently, they were cleansed of their liability by, in effect, giving a very high percentage of the company and its debt to the plaintiffs and their lawyers, I might add. And when we came along a year ago, I mean, that was all past history, but we probably wouldn't own the Johns Manville Company if it hadn't been for some asbestos litigation that started 20 years ago or more. And we may see actually more companies that end up in Berkshire that have been forced into bankruptcy through asbestos, but it is a, it's really a cancer on the American corporate world, and it's one that's growing, and I think I'll let Charlie talk about it.
Well, the asbestos liability situation in the country has morphed into a very disadvantageous situation where there's an enormous amount of fraud, and the wrong people are getting money, and there are vast profits for people who are arranging the fraud. And so it isn't a good situation. There's also real liability to people who have serious injuries, and some of those people are being deprived because meritless claims are taking so much of the money that there isn't adequate money in many cases for the people who've had the worst injuries. The Supreme Court has practically invited Congress to please step in and create a solution, but deterred by the plaintiff's contingency fee bar, Congress has refused to do anything. This is not a good situation. And any of you who can do anything about it, I would encourage you to do so.
What do you think it'll look like in 5 years, Charlie?
I would be surprised if there were a constructive solution. I think we'll have more of the mess we have now.
It's huge, too. Now, I mean, you there are companies that some of you may own stock in that have huge potential liabilities. They didn't think they had those liabilities, even maybe a few years ago, but they're finding ways to drag in almost anyone. And, you know, it's a concern when we buy businesses because we are a deep pocket, and a smaller company may not have been worth people investing lots of hours on a speculative idea that they could create some kind of a connection with, the ABC company and hundreds of thousands of people that are claimed to be sick. But it gets more interesting if Berkshire, it could get more interesting if Berkshire's involved. So it's a real problem for corporate America, and they have not been able, in effect, to come up with a solution. There was a solution, as I remember, and the Supreme Court didn't allow it. Isn't that right, Charlie?
That's right.
Yeah. We will be very careful, both in our insurance operations, but just as importantly, in our acquisitions and all of that, in terms of avoiding unnecessary exposure to asbestos liability. I'm not terrified at all about our insurance operation in terms of what's there from the past. I'm not saying that I know with any precision what the amounts will be, but that is not at the top of my list. But essentially, you will have a plaintiff's bar that, going beyond asbestos, will try to turn any kind of human adversity into a claim against somebody that's got a lot of money. And that's going on with mold. I mean, you may have seen Ed McMahon is suing his insurer for $20 million for the mold in his house. I just wish I could get some of that mold. I mean,
you probably have it.
Yeah. I hope you're referring to the house.
Okay. Area 4.
Good morning. My name is Ted Friedman. I'm from Cincinnati, Ohio. You said in a 1996 annual report that most investors will find that the best way to own common stocks is in an index fund that charges minimal fees. Two questions. First, there are a lot of different index funds that hold different baskets of stocks. What criteria would you use or recommend to select an appropriate index fund? Second, the price-to-earnings ratio of the S&P 500 is significantly higher than its historical average. What benchmark should an investor use in purchasing this index?
Yeah, I would say that in terms of the index fund, I would just take a very broad index. I would take the S&P 500 as long as I wasn't putting all my money in at one time. If I were going to put money into a index fund in relatively equal amounts over a 20 or 30 year period, I would pick a fund. And I know Vanguard has very low costs. I'm sure there are a whole bunch of others that do. I just haven't looked at the field, but I would be very careful about the costs involved. Because all they're doing for you is buying that index. I think that the people who buy those index funds on average will get better results than the people that buy funds that have higher costs attached to them, because it's just a matter of math. If you have a very high percentage of funds being institutionally managed, and a great many institutions charge a lot of money for doing it and others charge a little, they're going to get very similar gross results but different net results. And I recommend to all of you reading John Bogle's written a couple of books in the last 5 years, and I can't give you the titles, but they're very good books, and anybody investing in funds should read those books before investing, or if you've already invested, you still should read the books, and it's all you need to know, really, about fund investing. So I would pick a broad index, but I wouldn't toss a chunk in at any one time. I would do it over a period of time, because the very nature of index funds is that you are saying, I think America's business is going to do well over, or reasonably well over, a long period of time, but I don't know enough to pick the winners, and I don't know enough to pick the winning times. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't know enough to pick the winning times. Occasionally, I think I know enough to pick a winner, but not very often. And I certainly can't pick winners by going down through the whole list and saying, this is a winner, and this isn't, and so on. So the important thing to do, if you have an overall feeling that businesses a reasonable place to have your money over a long period of time, is to invest over a long period of time and not make any bet implicitly by putting a big chunk in at a given time. As to the criteria as to when you should or shouldn't, I don't think there are any great criteria on that. I don't think price earnings ratio, you know, determines things. I don't think price book ratios, price sales ratios. I don't think there's no single metric I can give you, or that anyone else can give you, in my view, that will tell you this is a great time to buy stocks or not to buy stocks or anything of the sort. It just isn't that easy. That's why you go to an index fund, and that's why you buy over a period of time. It isn't that easy. You can't get it by reading a magazine. You can't get it by, you know, watching television. You'd love to have something that said, you know, I mean, that you know, if PEs are 12 or below or some number, you buy, and if they're 25 or above, you sell. It doesn't work that way. It's a more complex business than that. It couldn't be that easy when you think about it. So if you are buying an index fund, you are protecting yourself against the fact that you don't know the answers to those questions, but that you think you can do well over time without knowing the answers to those questions, as long as you consciously recognize that fact. And, you know, I would, if you're a young person and you intend to save a portion of your income over time, I just say just pick out a very broad index, and I would probably use the S&P 500, because I think if you start getting beyond that, you start starting to think you should be in small caps this time and large caps that time, or this foreign side. And as soon as you do that, you know, you're in a game you don't know, you know, you're not equipped to play, in all candor. That would be my recommendation. Charlie?
I think his second worry is that common stocks could become so high-priced that if you bought index funds, you wouldn't expect to do very well. I didn't think I'd live long enough to think that was likely to happen, but now I think that may happen.
But probably what you're saying there is that they could get to a level and be at, they'd have to be at a sustained level like that for a long time.
They could be there and stay there for a long time.
In which case you might make 3 or 4%. But would there be anything way better than that around under those circumstances anyway? And pass the peanut brittle, please.
Well, in Japan, where something like this happened, the return from owning a nice index over the last 13 years or so is negative. Can something as horrible as that happen here? I mean, is it conceivable? I think the answer is yes.
But the option in Japan, of course, is to have deposits in a bank or own Japanese bonds at somewhere between 0 and 1 or 1.5%. So if rates on everything get very low, which means stocks sell very high, you know, then it just means that you live in a different world than existed 20 or 30 years ago when generally capital got paid better.
I must say that we have very good packaging.
Yeah. Yeah. Normally he does this in a less formal manner, but he's on his good behavior today.
We're protecting the integrity of the peanut brittle.
That is true. The package, the nature of anything with butter in it, you know, is it starts going downhill from the moment you make it. And therefore, this packaging has to be extraordinary in order to meet the quality standards that Charlie and I insist on. Okay, we'll go to zone 5.